For years, the New York Times Magazine has set a high bar for sophisticated editorial design, bringing together world-class writing with daring typographic systems and captivating art direction. All of this within an incredibly condensed timeline, which you'll hear about tonight. Gail Bichler has worked for The Times in many roles as a designer, an art director, and now currently as the magazine's design director, leading a team of talented designers and typographers, which has won a variety of awards from groups like the Art Directors Club, the Type Directors Club, and Creative Review. Gail herself is a member of the Alliance Graphique International and a former board member of the Society of Publication Designers. She is a graduate of the University of Michigan and has taught and lectured around the world, including as a visiting professor and critic at the Minneapolis College of Art and Design. So please join me in welcoming Gail Bichler.
Hello, everyone. Thanks to Emmett and to the rest of the Walker's design team for inviting me to speak here, and to the AIGA of Minnesota. I'm really honored to be here. I have a lot of magazine work that I want to show you, but first I'm going to tell you a little bit about how I got into my current position. So I started off working in Chicago at a small studio that designed mostly art books. And most of my training in school was actually in fine art, so I learned a ton about design and typography at my first job. And the first major project that I worked on at that job was a catalog for a show at the Museum of Contemporary Art. And that got reviewed in an international art magazine, and this is what the reviewer had to say. So that was disappointing. That was a pretty rough start to my career, but I learned early on that not everyone is going to like what you make. And that was a lesson that has been good for me that I've taken with me. In 2002, my husband was offered a job in Minneapolis working for Fallon. I don't do very well with cold weather, but we decided to come here. I thought Chicago was cold, but Minneapolis was definitely a lot colder. So I tried to follow advice about like embracing the winter. And you know, I tried winter sports. I tried broom ball. Are you all familiar with that? Yeah, I joined a league. And in terms of my work, I started my own studio doing work for publishers and cultural clients. But I actually had kind of a hard time. I figured out that I really don't like working by myself, and also that I need more structure. And also that I'm a really terrible broom ball player. So in 2004, we decided to move to New York. And I knew I didn't want to work for myself. I wanted to work for a cultural institution or a company. So I approached Janet Froelich, who was the creative director over the Sunday Magazine and T, the New York Times Style Magazine. And I had a portfolio of books. And she offered me some freelance work. And after about 9 months, I was hired onto the staff there by Rem Duplessis, who was the Sunday Magazine's art director. And that was about 15 years ago, which I realize is a really long time to stay in one place. But I really love my job. I get to work for an institution that I really believe in. I lead a team of really incredible designers. I get to visually comment on events happening in the world in real time. And I get to contribute to a magazine that has a really rich visual and journalistic history. So what you're looking at here is the first cover of the first magazine. It's been around since 1896. What you're looking at also are the first photographs that have ever been published in the New York Times. So it was originally a broadsheet. So it was actually a section of the paper. And it was established as a place for photography and for literary long-form writing. It was and still is a weekly general interest magazine distributed in the Sunday edition of the paper, which means that we make 52 issues per year, which is a lot of magazines. And we try to be as ambitious as we can every week. And in order to do that, we need to have a pretty big team. So this is the structure of the art department. It's 9 people, and we design everything related to the magazine, and also art direct and concept, many of the visuals. Everything we do is multi-platform, so we do things on mobile, web, and in print. And we're also doing doing a lot of live events. But we're actually part of a much bigger team. And our editor-in-chief is Jake Silverstein. We have an amazing photo department headed up by Kathy Ryan, who's our photo director. We have copy research and production teams. Someone likes Kathy? She is amazing. We also have something called NYT Mag Labs, which I will talk about a little bit more later. But all in all, it's about 50 people, and we also have a pretty vast network of freelancers, writers, photographers, and artists that we work with as well. And we're constantly interacting throughout the week. So this is our conference room. It's where we have our weekly ideas meeting, and this is a picture of our editors coming and pitching stories. You know, we have tons of conversation. This is about an illustration direction, and it's taking place in the art department. And we also have conversation surrounding design. I'm in this picture, I'm speaking with the magazine's art director, Matt Willey, and one of our designers. So it really truly is a team effort to make the magazine, and all of the work that I'm about to show you has been made through the combined efforts of all of the people on our team over the past 5 years. So one of the pleasures of working at the magazine is that we cover a huge variety of topics. So I'm going to quickly show you a bunch of covers to give you a sense of that variety and the varied approaches that we take. We do a lot of profiles. This was for a profile on the artist Chuck Close. This was for a profile on Lorde, and it was about her process in writing music. So the circles are an abstract reference to synesthesia, which is a condition where a stimulation in one sense triggers an experience in another sense. So when she hears music, she sees color. Last year, we ran a story on Russian information wars, and that was about how the Kremlin is using the media to send out misleading information. We actually published this before Brexit, so it was kind of prescient. We published this in 2015, and it was a story on Europe's terrible year about terrorism and the migrant crisis and economic issues that they were facing. This is a cover that we recently published this past November, right after the Pittsburgh synagogue shootings. And we had a writer working on this story, and it was about law enforcement's failure to deal with the rise of anti-Semitism in the US. And she had been working on it for about a year, but when the shootings happened, we rushed the story to print because of the events of that week. And the photograph in this image looks like it comes from the Nazi era, but it was actually shot in April 2018 in Georgia. So it's scary. And on the left is a list of extremist incidents and rallies that have happened over the past few years, many of which were violent. This one is for a story on the video game Minecraft, which it turns out is good for kids. This was a story on Boko Haram's child soldiers, and it was specifically about four boys who were abducted from a fishing village and forced to do really terrible things as soldiers. And they eventually escaped, but they hadn't told anyone their stories until they spoke to our writer. And so they were afraid that when we published the story, Boko Haram would find them and kill them, or that the Nigerian government would imprison them. So the crop was really to protect this boy's identity. And this is another close crop, but for a very different reason. This was a story that we published just a few weeks ago on a Dutch art dealer who identified two new Rembrandts. So we wanted to give the impression of up-close examination, and also zooming in on the logo was another kind of trick to do that. We are publishing a ton of political stories for obvious reasons. We published this cover the week after Trump was elected for a story that was about how the country was divided. Thanks. This was for a story about Trump's relationship with Congress and the language are his tweets about members of Congress who he was now going to have to work with. This was for a story about the Democratic Party following the 2016 presidential election and how Obama's popularity really masked deeper problems within the party and how the Democrats really have no plan moving forward. This was for a story on mainstreaming the use of psychedelic drugs to treat mental health issues. One about a war in the right-wing talk media. For a story about making a movie about Edward Snowden. And this was for a story about Google and antitrust laws. And the story asked the question, is Google too powerful? So as you can see, we make a lot of different kinds of covers. For some, the visual solution is a portrait or a documentary shot of a place or an event. And for others, it's really more about communicating an idea graphically. And I think those are the hardest ones to make, but also I find them to be the most enjoyable. And I'm going to talk a little bit about how we approach these. So this is how we usually get stories in the art department in manuscript form. You know, a lot of times we get something that's really rough and can change quite a bit before we publish. But for me, a lot of my ideas come through language. So I often read through a manuscript a couple times and, you know, sketch in the margins and pull out, you know, underline things that I think suggest a visual. And then every Monday we have a meeting where we discuss the upcoming cover stories and talk about the approach that we want to take for the art. Our stories are usually between 5 and 10,000 words long. So in that meeting, I usually ask our editor, Jake, to try and tell me the main point of the story in one sentence. This is an exercise that he does not love. But it's really helpful to me because I then can not only know the main point of the story, really what the visual needs to convey, but also the tone and how they're going to frame it. And I meant to actually mention that the general time frame for these covers is usually somewhere between 2 weeks and 2 days for conceptual covers. And I would say a typical time frame would be about 5 days. So with that information about what the story is going to, what the main point of the story is, we will often reach out to an illustrator or an artist and ask them to come up with ideas. Other times we come up with our own ideas. I tend to present mine in a really rough form. I know my sketches always look like scribbles. This is a sketch for a cover of our 2015 Innovations issue, which was about the role of failure in innovations. And so my idea was to do a failed cover try. And that was the cover. So we have a lot of creative freedom. And one of the reasons that we have that is because we're not a newsstand magazine. So we come wrapped in the Sunday paper, and we get to do a lot of things, like we can cover our logo, and we can publish images of really tough stories, things that people would not necessarily be attracted to on the newsstand. And another reason that we have that freedom is the relationship that I have with Jake and the trust that he has in me and in my department. And that was something that was built over time. This is a sketch for one of the early covers that I worked on with Jake. He's been with the magazine for about 5 years. And initially, when he got here, I was the art director. And I was hoping to be promoted, so I wanted to impress him. And this was a story about the senator, Rand Paul. And he was considering making a run for the presidency as a Republican. And the story talked a lot about his youth appeal. So my idea was to take the elephant, the Republican symbol, and find ways to make it feel youthful and cool. So, you know, on a nose ring or a tattoo. And I think these were perfectly good ideas, but they would have made for pretty traditional magazine covers. So 3 days before we sent this to the printer, I decided to try a different approach and was thinking about a paragraph in the piece that talked about different politicians and who they would be if they were bands. Which, you know, made me think about making a cover that was in the style of a gig poster. And I thought that would be a more unconventional way to show Rand Paul's youthful appeal. And it was also an approach that we were pursuing on the inside for the design. So we used these punk band posters as inspiration. And we made this cover. We work with Matt Dorfman on this, who's a really great illustrator, who is also the art director of the book review at the Times. But I'm going to show you a couple of my favorite details, the anarchy symbol and the logo. And also, I just wanted to point out this line at the bottom because it's really only there to support that idea of this being a band poster. And you know, also, the headline is written towards that idea. And that is why the editor-art director relationship is so important, really, because the best covers are the ones where text and image work together. And Jake told me later that this was the cover that got me promoted into the design director role, which I think it was because of my willingness to take a look at my own idea and try and, you know, unprompted, really improve it and do something interesting and unusual. So pretty quickly after that, we started making work that was riskier and pushed the boundaries a lot more. This was 2 weeks later for a story about how women get abortions in places where it's illegal. And this was a month later for a kids-themed food issue. It's an illustration by Christoph Niemann. Now, in 2015, we redesigned the magazine. And for our launch issue, we wanted to have a global theme. And we decided to make 4 covers to commemorate it. So what you're looking at is Maurizio Catalan and Pier Paolo Ferrari's cover. But when we first reached out to them and asked them to make an image that dealt with the idea of going global, they sent this. And I love this, but had just no idea what it means. It was a press conference with fried chicken microphones. So we went back to them and asked them to give us another option. And they came back with this, which we also really liked a lot. But we decided that it didn't really visually convey the idea that this was a comment on the state of the world. So we asked him to try something that incorporated a globe. And we decided that that was something that maybe could tie all four of the covers together. And so these were all of the covers that we published. Now, as part of a national news organization, we're subject to a lot of scrutiny. And to give you a sense of what that's like, I'm just going to play you a news clip that ran on a local news station in New Mexico after the relaunch.
This is a recent cover from the newly relaunched New York Times magazine. The Italian artists who drew it say it shows someone erasing the surface of a troubled earth. But when you take a closer look, you can see they left out a pretty important word, the new in New Mexico.
Yep. It's a very slow news day. But they took it really seriously, and they actually took it to the streets.
But we wanted to know how New Mexicans feel about the cover of such a big magazine. So I took a picture on my cell phone and asked.
It's crazy to me that people think it's part of Mexico.
It's not surprising, but it's kind of annoying.
Okay. In October 2000, we published our first cover story on Trump since he entered the 2016 presidential race. And we were one of the last magazines to actually put him on the cover because our national correspondent thought that he might go away. So we wanted to do something with a point of view that would really set us apart from the other covers that had been published. And we decided to do this cover of Trump as a helium balloon and make it purposely ambiguous. You know, we don't have any lines on there. We're kind of leaving it up to the reader to decide if someone's holding the balloon, if it's drifting off the page, that kind of thing. And this is a sequence of the art direction. We work with the illustrator Stan Chow. And in my mind, the first image is Trump on a balloon, and the last is Trump as a balloon. And the versions in between are just correcting for the distortion that happens when you put an illustration on a curved surface, and also facial details, getting those right, like the skin tone in the last frame. And then we made a bunch of these balloons, about 25 of them. And we shot them in various states of inflation and in different positions. And I find that people are actually usually really surprised that we made the balloons for this instead of using Photoshop or CG. But we really try as often as possible to make the objects that we put on our covers. Another example of that is our 2016 design issue, and it was on redesigns. And it would definitely have been a lot easier to make this digitally, but we didn't. And I think photographing a real object often lends a certain authenticity that readers can feel, and I think it's worth doing when possible. So right after the 2017 Women's March, we were publishing a story on the new feminist movement and the tensions within that movement. And these are all the sketches that I showed Jake for that cover. And he really liked one idea that I had, which was knitting the word resist in hot pink yarn and fraying it, which was a nod to the pink pussy hats. And so I wanted to work with Jessica Walsh on this because I thought that the execution really had to be just right for it to work, for it not to feel twee or to feel like a craft project. But I also asked her to come up with some of her own ideas, just in case this wasn't going to work out or maybe she would have a better idea than what I had. This was my favorite idea that she presented. which was that she wanted to dye a cat pink and then have it like pawing at like the reader with the lines that said "Pussy grabs back," and I was a little bit worried about just the process of dyeing a cat and whether or not that's safe and humane. But she was definitely sure that she could do it and that it was humane. But we in the end decided that it didn't quite convey the idea of tensions in the movement, even though we thought it would have made a pretty amazing cover. So we ended up proceeding with the knit type idea, and then it became all about the execution. And we didn't want it to be too trendy or too fashion-y. We really wanted it to feel strong. And so we ended up settling on this, but also agreed that distressing the type would really give it its editorial edge. And by that, I mean that this almost feels like a command to resist, whereas this feels like a comment about tensions within the movement. So this is them working on the actual knitted letters and distressing them. They're a slightly lighter pink than we wanted, but we went through a lot of versions of letters looking at what would fray in the best way. So we ended up color correcting it to look like this. So 6 months into the Trump administration, we published a profile on the Capitol during a really tumultuous time. Lately, our political coverage often comes in super late just because of the pace that things are happening in Washington. So as this piece was being written, we were making the cover, and I knew that specific scenes would be talked about, but I also knew I wasn't gonna know what those scenes were until 3 days before this went to press. So what I decided to do was make one image that had everything that had happened in the past 6 months in it. And we worked with the illustrator Andrew Ray on this. I'm gonna show you some of my favorite details. So the aide on the roof of the White House trying to catch the Twitter birds. Definitely wanted a swamp creature in the mix. Steve Bannon's skin tone. And that's actually Andrew Ray. He put himself in there, which I thought was funny. In August 2017, we published a story on Michael Deng, who was a college student who died in a hazing ritual at an Asian fraternity. And it was different from other stories about fraternity hazing deaths because it was really more about the search for identity that a lot of Asian students experience in college. And so it was a lot about why he joined the fraternity in the first place. And I pitched an idea of shooting his fraternity sweatshirt in a really moody way as a possible cover image. And Jake really liked that. But then at the very last minute, he changed his mind. And he thought that that was not visually enough about that idea of a search for identity. So I had to come up with another solution on the fly. And the only image I had of Michael Deng was this picture that you're seeing. I think it was a yearbook picture. And this is what we published, which looks like a blurred photograph, but actually is a painting made by the Mies brothers. So I commissioned this on a Friday night at 6 p.m., about 1 hour after we determined the sweatshirt was not gonna work. And I had the finished cover image on Monday morning. So sometimes it's very fast-paced. This was the only cover sketch that I made for a package that we did on sexual harassment. And it was about conversations between women in the wake of the Weinstein revelations. And it was just a really simple, direct approach. And I worked again with Jessica Walsh on this. And these are all the different versions of the lettering she tried. I think when a concept is simple, that's when the details often become really important, when the execution can really make or break something. And I wanted the hand of the writer in this to, I wanted you to be able to feel the hand of the writer in the lettering and feel a sense of urgency and anger. I've focused a lot on cover so far, but now I'd like to talk to you about the interior of the magazine, and specifically about our use of typography. Because the magazine's really stripped down, they're not like a lot of extra design elements or flourishes. Typography is really our main tool for not only conveying our message, but also getting across a tone and a look and feel that's right for each piece. In 2015, when we relaunched the magazine, we worked with Henrik Kubel of A2 to come up with a set of custom typefaces for use in the magazine. And we have three main fonts. One is a slab serif that you're looking at here. We also have a sans and a serif font. And these fonts were designed to work together, but meant to also have very different tones so that they could accommodate the variety of content that the magazine covers. And so this is the entirety of the suite. It's about 40 weights and cuts in all. I believe Henrik did this in about 2 months, and I don't think he slept at all. But I'm going to show you some spreads of the typeface in use. And so this is our sans in a story on PTSD. This is our serif in a literary story about the role of manners or lack of them in society today. This is a more aggressive treatment with our condensed slab for a story about attempts to make rugby appealing to Americans. And an italicized version of our serif for a piece on Jared Kushner's real estate business practices. Sometimes the type is quieter when the image is doing more of the heavy lifting. This was a story about how teenagers are getting most of their information about sex through porn. And this was a story about the role that racism plays in the heightened mortality rates of black mothers and babies And the design really needed to take a back seat here because the topic was so serious. I think restraint can be a powerful tool, but it can kind of also sometimes seem like a default. But often when we do that, we've tried a number of other solutions before settling on the simple one. So this was the first headline we got for this piece, which was twice as vulnerable. We also tried this. But these actually felt tonally off to me. They just felt like maybe a little too clever for the topic. So we're often asking ourselves, like, you know, does it feel right to introduce a design idea on top of the actual content of the story? And sometimes the answer is no, and it just really needs to be more simple. So the classic challenge of magazines is that every week you have the same font and the same format, and really different stories. So you try to come up with innovative ways to use your toolkit of fonts to tell stories with type. In our relationship, we do a lot of that, but we also look outside of our arsenal of fonts to tell a story. So our relationship with Henrik has been really great for that, in that he's become a frequent collaborator with the magazine. So this is a font that he drew for us. It's a super tall version of our slab serif, and he drew it as a one-off for this story about the Greek financial crisis. And he also drew a stencil version of our serif font for a health issue that we ended up liking so much that we kind of started using it in the magazine every so often. We've also sometimes used A2 fonts in conjunction with our own. This is Henrik's new grotesque along with our sans serif. And actually, many designers at the magazine make their own lettering or typography. And you might wonder why we would choose to do that when there's so many fonts already out there that are great. And sometimes it's about getting a specific visual reference. For example, for this piece about a dinner party in New York, our deputy art director, Ben Granginet, wanted the layout to have a subtle New York feel, so he decided to draw this font based on old New York City subway posters. And sometimes it's about control, and this is type drawn by the magazine's art director, Matt Willey, and in this case, it was just about having letters that fit perfectly into these colored boxes. So people in the magazine industry often say that if your magazine is well-branded, you could see a single page of it in isolation, and you would know what magazine it came from. And type is often a big tool for that, but even with all the typographic variation in the magazine, I still think that the magazine is recognizable as a brand, and I think it's actually the typographic experiment and also even just the idea of trying to visualize the content through the design that are really the defining traits of it. So I'm going to show you a video of openers from the magazine just to give you more of a sense of what the magazine looks like from week to week. And on a typical week, we have four feature stories on different topics. So 16 times a year, we do themed issues, and those tend to be some of our most ambitious packages, and it's often where we're thinking about the magazine structured differently. For example, this is our 2018 music issue, and instead of having four features, it uses a list of 25 songs as jumping off points to talk about music. And so we did a split run of covers that were shot by the photographer Ryan McKinley. And we really thought they did a great job of giving a sense of movement and joy and really capturing the spirit of music. And the interior was this really rough and ready zine aesthetic that related to the fluidity and energy of music. And so I mentioned earlier that all of our stories in the magazine appear in print and also digitally. So this is the digital presentation of this issue, which I think is particularly good because you can actually hear the music.
You can't hang her, I'm a black. Nope. And I just check my accounts. Turns out I'm rich, I'm rich, I'm rich. I put my head above my hip. I bet you dip, he dip, she dip. I say, I get the money and go. This shit is hot.
Are we crazy?
So the most extensive redesign of the magazine that we've ever done for a special issue was our 2016 New York issue, which had a sub-theme of life above 800 feet. And for the cover, we sent photographer Jimmy Chin to the top of One World Trade Spire to take this picture, which we published as a fold-out cover. And then the magazine's art director, Matt, had the idea to flip the entire issue 90 degrees so that we could create a really vertical format to show New York super tall buildings. And so then our photo team specially commissioned all the art in the magazine for this new format. And it was important to us that everything be in a vertical orientation because we didn't want our readers to have to keep flipping back and forth. We thought that would be a bad reading experience. So even the ads were turned, as you can see here. And in order to do that, our ad sales team had to convince all of our advertisers to go back and redesign their ads to fit the new format. And also, I think Matt made about 40 mock-ups of what this thing would look like that the sales team was using. So, but they did get every last one of those ads turned. And he drew a typeface for the issue. And again, you know, there are a lot of condensed fonts out there that we could have used, but Matt drew this one to be super simple so that it would be really easy to lengthen and shorten it to fit in the spaces that we had to work with. And that allowed him to do things like this. And this. And I have to give credit to Jake because I think most editors would have just dismissed this idea out of hand. But he went with it, and he also had the editorial team write and rewrite headlines to work with the design. Even when we were like, seven letters. Can we do something with seven letters? This is a map of the building, all the buildings over 800 feet in Manhattan. Initially, we thought that the theme should be life over 1,000 feet. That just seemed like a better number. But it turns out that there's just not enough life up that high. So we adjusted. This is an essay about nature above 800 feet. I think this is the biggest type we've ever published in the magazine. And you know, we realized as we were making this that the type was actually pretty hard to read, but we felt like it was actually functioning more as illustration. So we were okay with that. And we made sure that all the important information was in the subhead. Now, initially I said this was a great way to showcase super tall buildings, the format change, but this was one of my favorite spreads because I thought it was really powerful to come to this place in the magazine and get this larger than life portrait of one of the construction workers working at these heights. We could never have just gotten that kind of scale if we had been in the regular format. Just a few more pages. And even the crossword was turned. And the issue was pretty well received. For the most part, we knew we would get criticism. But we make this was one out of 52 issues that we make per year, which allows us to be a little freer and take some risks. But you know, that said, we only do this when we really think it would add to the content or the experience of the magazine. And this is what it looked like online. So some of our special issues are annual, which means that which means that we have to reapproach them every year. So we try to take a really different attack. So this was our 2017 New York issue. That was the year after the Super Tall Buildings one. And we decided to make it about New York stories and make it an all comics issue. The cover was done by Bill Bragg, and here is a little process animation to show you how it was made. So what we did in this issue was we paired comic book artists with stories that were written by our Metro reporters. And I really love this approach because it really came out of the DNA of the magazine as a magazine attached to a newspaper. And so in addition to having the feature stories in the comic style, we wanted everything to be in that format. So this is a contributor's page on a typical week. And this is how it looked in the All Comics issue. Tom Gauld hand drew our entire front of book, and we also replaced all of the type with a font that was made from his handwriting. Again, he even drew the crosswords. I bring this up because the crosswords, it's tough to mess with them. I feel like people get really angry. It's a lot of people's favorite thing in the magazine. And this is how the rest of the issue looked. Now, in August of 2015, we devoted one entire issue of the magazine to a 40,000-word story, and it was about the history of Arab Spring, and it was told through the eyes of six people whose lives it changed. And this was the product of 18 months of reporting by Scott Anderson, and also the photographer Paolo Pellegrin shot images that were current day about the stories, but we also were able to draw on 20 years of his shooting in that region, his whole archive. And from the start, we had envisioned this as feeling kind of like a book. We ended up getting some funding from the Pulitzer Center, which allowed us to get rid of all of the ads. So we made this wraparound cover. And I'm going to show you the first 20 pages of the magazine spread by spread, just to give you a sense of what it was like. So this is the inside cover and the first page. So it's a very stripped down opening. And I guess as I'm showing you this, if you think about what a magazine usually looks like, you know, it's usually filled with ads and it's quite busy. This is the only ad that was in the magazine on the left side here, which was more of a statement of purpose from the Pulitzer Center. So you'll notice that with this issue, we had no drop caps, no pull quotes, none of the kind of normal magazine devices. We really wanted it to be rigidly formatted because we wanted to give this issue a really serious tone and stature. And we eventually did take this project to its logical conclusion, and we made it into a book. This is the cover of our Voyages issue that we just published this past fall. And the issue took you on 11 sonic voyages, which were places that hopefully looked amazing, but more importantly, sounded amazing. And it came with a soundtrack that you could listen to, almost like if you were in a tour in an audio museum. So this is the opening spread of the feature well, and it's a photograph by Philip Montgomery, excuse me, of lava flowing from Kilauea volcano in Hawaii. And apart from the index and a brief introduction, the whole issue had no text. It was just 50 pages of full-bleed images and a small number at the top left to tell you what track you should be listening to. And the project was hugely ambitious. It meant sending photographers and field recordists around the world and producing various downloadable tracks. And we even did a live event of this issue in front of an audience. And this is how it worked online. You were given an option right at the start, asking if you had the print magazine. And if you did, you could simply listen to the tracks. Or you could experience the whole thing online.
Welcome to the Voyages issue of the New York Times Magazine. I'm your host, Jake Silverstein, the editor-in-chief of the magazine. And today, we're going to go all around the planet, looking and listening. We're going to visit all the places marked on this map in front of you, and as we move along, you can scroll to advance or use your arrow keys, or you can just sit back and relax, and the whole experience will autoplay.
I put my favorite destination in this issue here.
We're back, and our next destination is an urban one, the busy streets of New York City, one of the noisiest places on Earth.
It's it's an acoustic mess. There's horns blaring and, you know, people shouting on the street.
That's Brian House, a sound artist from Brooklyn.
For a rat, it's not such a noisy place. The city is actually quiet above the human range of hearing. There's room acoustically up in those higher frequencies where the rats can actually hear each other talk. That's all rats. It's rat voices in downtown Manhattan. So when rats are socializing and courting each other and chastising their kids and everything, they're doing that, you know, way above our range of hearing. And I've recorded that using an ultrasonic microphone and lowered the pitch into the human vocal range. The other thing that we know about these sounds is that it includes rat laughter. And there's no mistaking it. You know, when you hear it, it's like, oh, that's okay. that's the rat laughing. But what I think is that it is an acoustic niche. You know, part of how rats are adapted to live in these urban environments is that they have their own acoustics. They have their own soundscape of the city.
Some destinations were more exotic than others. So I've just shown you a number of the special issues where we really altered the format the most. But since our special issues are such a big part of our brand, and because we put a lot of our best design work into them, I'm going to show you just a clip of a number of other of our recent ones. Starting with this weekend's Voyages issue that was about travel that changes you. Has become a place for innovation within the times. We're in this kind of unique position because we're part of this huge organization, but we're also a smaller, more nimble group within a group. So we're able to take more risks. We could have more flexibility and room to experiment. And for that reason, we've launched a bunch of projects for the Times as an organization. So in the fall of 2015, the magazine launched a virtual reality platform. And we partnered with Google to distribute 1.4 million cardboard viewers to our subscribers. And, you know, a lot of news organizations were starting to experiment with virtual reality, so we certainly weren't the first ones. But we were the first to make it available to the public in mass, and we were able to do that through our print subscription service, which is kind of ironic because it was actually our print delivery option that allowed us to make this really, you know, cutting-edge technology available. So the week that we sent out the cardboard, we published a story that followed three children displaced by war, one from Lebanon, one from the Ukraine, and one from South Sudan, and showed what their lives were like. A lot of people were publishing things in virtual reality that were very experiential, like taking you places that maybe you couldn't go. Our goal with this was to really try and bring the journalistic of Times, the journalistic power of the Times to the project. And we started working on this about 6 months before we released it. And the impetus for it was that Jake saw a headline on the front page of the paper that noted that there were currently the largest number of refugees since World War II, and that over half of them were children. So the main event was a VR film. This is not the film because you would need the cardboard to view it, but it's a desktop simulation. And this is Shaul, a 9-year-old South Sudanese boy. And when civil war broke out, fighters came to his village, and he saw his grandfather and father brutally killed. They were herded into a hut, and the hut was lit on fire, and they were burned alive. So he fled to the swamps with his mother and his grandmother, and in the chaos, he got separated from his mother. So he swam and waded through snake and alligator infested water for about 3 weeks until he reached a small island, which was home to about 80,000 other displaced people. This is Oleg, the boy from the Ukraine. He was 11 years old when war broke out in his village, and his family took shelter in a neighboring village. And when he returned, they found that almost all of the village's houses had been destroyed, including his own, and his school was destroyed as well. So one thing that we discovered while we were making this film was that virtual reality is really an incredibly powerful format for storytelling in terms of generating empathy. Because when you're watching something on a screen, there's a certain amount of remove. You know, you can have a certain amount of distance. But in virtual reality, you often feel like you're there, and you're paddling around in a swamp or standing with a child in a bombed-out building where he used to go to school, and you can look down and see the rubble and look up and see the sky through a hole in the ceiling. And it feels immediate, and it feels very moving. A lot of the reaction that we got to these films that were that, you know, people were crying. On the opposite end of the spectrum from virtual reality, we're also thinking about the future of the print newspaper. And the magazine is making highly designed print-only special sections of the paper. I mentioned when I showed the kind of organizational chart that we have a department called NYT Mag Labs, which is headed up by the art director of that section, Deb Bishop. And it's a group within the magazine that is dedicated to thinking about or to applying magazine thinking to a lot of different types of projects. And the goal is to really use the broadsheet format in interesting ways and to get people excited about the paper, and design plays a really outsized role in that. So this is a section we released on July 4th of last year, and it's about our Constitution and how it's traditionally been interpreted versus how it's being interpreted under the Trump administration. And the whole Constitution was printed on the backside, and it was heavily annotated by historians and legal scholars and comedians. And this is the most recent special section that we did. And actually, this one is online, which is kind of unusual for us. But this was dedicated to a photographic portfolio of our printing plant in College Point, Queens. And it was by a photographer named Christopher Payne, who spent 2 years photographing the plant and I think made some really spectacular images. NYT Mag Labs also publishes a kids section, and this started as a one-off, but because of the positive responses to it, we actually make it monthly now. I think a lot of the readers are actually grown-ups, because it does break things down in a really simple and easy-to-understand way that I think is really appealing. And this is a sneak peek, actually. This comes out this coming weekend, of our most recent kids section, which is a humor issue. It's a game. I appreciated that illustration where about how to roast parents there at the bottom left. And the magazine's most recent experiment is in video. Over the past year, we've made a weekly short video series that's made for use on social media that explains our covers and kind of gives insight into the process of making them. And this one is for the cover of last week's Voyages issue. From the New York Times Magazine, this is Behind the Cover.
I'm Jake Silverstein, editor-in-chief.
And I'm Gail Bichler, design director.
This week we have a very fun issue. It's our spring Voyages issue, stories about travel from all over the world. And on the cover we have Rick Steves, the travel guru who has been encouraging Americans to travel since the 1970s.
Initially we really wanted to photograph Rick in Europe, but he didn't have any trips planned, so we decided to bring Europe to him.
We like the idea of seeing Rick Steves in a whole bunch of different kind of postcard European settings.
We really wanted to work with Zach Scott on this. Rather than portraits, he creates whole scenes. Rick Steves was amazing. He was all in on this concept and really brought a lot to it.
In the end, we were more drawn to a sort of magical but less specific scene, a kind of alpine meadow.
You really get the sense that it's tongue-in-cheek.
But it also is truly an earnest cover about something that we do believe in.
Right.
A great travel experience can make you feel as if you've transcended the person that you are when you're back home and experienced something new in the world.
Yeah, that was an unusual one for us. Sometimes it's ISIS on the cover, sometimes it's Rick Steves in a meadow. So this is the last thing I'm going to talk about. I've talked a lot about the ambition of the magazine, and I'm going to wrap up with the most ambitious cover that we've ever made. This we published in September 2015. It was for a themed issue on walking in New York. This project was led by our incredible photo team, who commissioned JR, the artist, to paste an image of a walking figure on the ground of the Flatiron Plaza in Manhattan. The process started at 4 a.m. JR had a group of volunteers that showed up. They pasted down 62 strips of paper, and they made a 150-foot image. And then JR flew overhead and photographed it in a helicopter with people walking over it. And a lot of people really weren't aware that they were even walking over it, because when you were down on the ground, it kind of just looked like texture. And we also had to do a lot of research about like exactly when to get that helicopter up there to make sure that we didn't get a bunch of shadows in the picture. My husband and my son are walking around in there somewhere. So this all happened within a day. We had someone come in with a power washer and uninstall it at 7 p.m. And here's the cover. And here's the inevitable tweet that came. And that's it. And I just wanted to put up the names of all of the people on our visual teams, so that just to have that up there. But I can take questions now. No questions.
The work is insane. It's so, so good. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
The one question I had, well, I have like a million questions, but I'll reserve to one. How many projects are you working on concurrently, and how long in advance are you working on them?
So we're working on a ton of different projects concurrently. We have like a lot of different balls up in the air. We're always working. We work about 8 days ahead. So the thing that we ship on a Friday, well, in terms of design, the thing that we ship on a Friday appears like the next Sunday in the paper. But, you know, obviously there's some certain things that have been planned quite a bit out, like the JR project. We actually got 5 weeks out on that. this last cover that I showed. And a lot of times what we're doing is we have this like list of upcoming stories. And as soon as we see something that's on the list that doesn't have art, we try and get as much information about it as possible and, you know, either come up with a conceptual solution or send a photographer to photograph it. So we're constantly having meetings about upcoming stories throughout the day as we're working on the current issue. And then a lot of times, you know, with these special issues, we usually have a designer that heads that up. So oftentimes we'll have like one or two people peeled off from the group who are not working on the current issue, who are trying to come up with design solutions for upcoming special issues. And I try to encourage people on the team to think about it as far ahead in advance as they can. But usually what they're given to work on it is about 2 weeks before the week of the ship. It's just kind of things kind of constantly in motion.
Compliments, really fabulous work. I only do one a year. I don't know how you do 52, but how do you arrange your life to ever take time off?
Yeah, that's a good question. I cannot see who's up there. Okay, great. The job is pretty full on. I don't have like a great work-life balance. But I also really enjoy the job. And so I spend a lot of time doing it, but I enjoy the hours that I'm there. I work with a great team of wonderful people whose company I also enjoy, which is fantastic. There are times when I feel like I really thrive on the pace, the, you know, kind of every week. And, you know, there really is no, it's pretty relentless. There's no breaks. And I mean, I've worked there for 15 years, so you know, there's never been a week when we haven't published it, although there's been plenty of times when I wished that, like, you know, we could just publish a special double issue right before the holidays. And I've pitched that. It has never gone through. You have to be able, that's the reason we have the incredible team that we have. So, you know, the people that I work with in my department, you know, I go away and they make an amazing magazine without me. You know, it's just, it's really the fact that it's a team that makes it, that makes it possible.
Hi, incredible work. I'm over here to your other side waving. Hi.
Okay. Why can I not get it?
Yeah. No, it's hard. I just was wondering, given how full on it is, what are the qualities you're looking for in designers or illustrators, photographers when you partner with them? Kind of what makes a successful attitude and skill set?
Do you mean like for people that we hire in our group or just like the people that we commission to work on projects with us?
I guess I'm kind of thinking of both. Yeah. Or.
Well, so as far as the artists that we hire to work on projects like covers or art for pieces, we are usually looking for, it varies so much. You know, sometimes we go to people and, you know, we go to them because they are great at coming up with conceptual ideas. And we don't have an idea for how a piece, you know, should be arted, and we think they might have a really good idea. Sometimes we go to somebody when we have an idea that, and we have an idea for how it should be executed. And, you know, a lot of times, I feel like because of the internet, certain styles proliferate. And so what we really try and do is look for people that have a pretty unique style and are kind of someone that we feel is doing the best of that certain kind of thing. Also people who can deliver things in a time crunch under a lot of pressure. But as far as who we hire for designers within the group, it's often people who are really interested in the content, you know, people who really like to read, are really interested in the news, and are really ambitious and excited about what we make. I'm often, because it's so full on, the job, I'm often trying to like give the designers in my group a break. You know, I think about, oh, you had a really hard week, you just did a special issue, or, you know, if they had a particularly hard week, I try to make maybe the next week a little lighter for them. And I find that they often get mad because everyone there really just likes to make the work and they enjoy doing it. And I mean, to be honest, also because we spend so much time together, I look for people that I just like and whose company I enjoy.
I ask? I'm not an artist, but I have a very strong, right here.
Okay.
I have a really strong feelings about typeface and reading fast and comprehending. Mm-hmm. So could you talk about the change in the typeface that you've done and what people thought? And
well, so which one? I mean, we change everything.
Yeah, I know you change everything, but I'm really talking about the main, not the art part, but the reading part.
Okay. Yep. So it's interesting that you asked that because when we did our relaunch in 2015, we did change the body font. And that was mostly because we thought the magazine would feel better if every one of the fonts that we used had Henrik's sensibility. We thought it would feel more unified. But when we did that, we also knew that we were going to have a lot of challenges in trying to design a typeface that would work as a body font for this magazine, which clearly values the writing very much, and it should. So what we ended up doing was taking our serif font, and we took a lot of the angles out of it. We softened it a lot. We raised the X height. We did a bunch of things. We knew that if we didn't make the new font that we were proposing more legible than the font we were using, that we would never be able to replace it. And so we did. and I think it's pretty legible. And, you know, I get a fair number of comments about the legibility in the magazine. I think that's the thing that is most commented on. Usually it's people who think it's not legible and want to hate on it for a little bit. And I think there's kind of a line. I mean, we're definitely making something that is for a general audience, not a design audience. It's for everyone. And so it needs to be accessible. At the same time, we want to push the boundaries and make something interesting and something that people haven't seen. And I think that we're lucky that our editor, Jake, also understands that, you know, if they're going to push with the content and the writing, that it's okay to sometimes take some risks and make readers work with the design as well. And so, you know, there are points when we do sacrifice legibility, like in headlines. And often, you know, we think of them sometimes as design elements. But, you know, we try to do that in cases where the content, it feels right for the content. But our main goal is to get this information out there in a way that is appealing and a way that draws people in. Hope that answers it.
Yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Hi.
Okay, thank
you. I just want to add on to what she was talking about. How do you look for in the next designer? What do you ever ask them a twit question? Like, for example, what do you do outside of work? What do you like to do?
Do you consider that a trick question?
Yeah, like during the interview. Like, how do you hire like the best team?
No, we do ask them things like that, you know. I sometimes get recommendations. We look at people's, we really look at the work that they make and also, you know, just kind of get a general sense, like I said, of their interests. And, you know, a lot of times we will bring in people and test them out for a little bit. Like, we'll bring them in as freelancers, you know, and sometimes, you know, it can be hard. It's hard to tell sometimes whether or not someone has potential. But we take a fair number of risks on that front, and we've been pretty lucky because we've had a lot of really fantastic designers at the magazine.
Yeah, you're lucky.
Yeah.
That's some struggle.
Yeah.
Hi. So I have... pretty new to the design industry, and I've noticed that there's this dichotomy between print designers and digital designers, mm-hmm. Where it's like, oh, I'm only print, or oh, I'm only digital, and you don't mix between. And they're at odds with each other. Sometimes I can see print and digital peacefully coexisting, but this is the first time, or one of the best examples I've seen of them working together towards a common goal, and one being specifically print and the other one being specifically digital, but still and the same theme, in the same vein.
Mm-hmm.
What's your secret?
Oh, that's a good question. It's taken us a long time to get there. You know, I come from a print background, and I love the craft of print. And it is actually, I think it's hard to find people who have skills, you know, both in terms of the craft of typography and design, and then also are adept programmers and that kind of thing. So, you know, we have spent a lot of time looking for those kinds of people. And I think that one of the things that we've been trying to do as we shift our thinking more towards digital is really think about things that we can't really make anything that's digital first, to be honest, because we make a really work-intensive print product, and it comes first. You know, it's the thing that we make first. But there are a number of projects that we are now doing where we're just starting to think about, we often think about, you know, what the digital will be and let that kind of guide the experience. So, for example, the Voyages issue that we did, that was, you know, obviously conceived as something that had sound initially, and most of the effort really went into that idea of what it would be like online and what that experience would be like. So it's really, I think, about trying to look at a story and decide what the medium is that would, you know, make it the most compelling, and then trying to design for that medium. And we're also, you know, more and more not as attached to having both things be the same. So, you know, if you know, one experience makes sense for online and it's a different experience for print, we're okay with that. I don't know if our readers are so much okay with it, because I think there's a certain feeling that, you know, if you get the magazine, you should be able to experience whatever you experience in print also digitally. But yeah, we are kind of moving more towards just trying to craft certain experiences for the medium that they seem best suited for.
Hi there.
Hello.
You've done a wonderful job of presenting, you know, you showed the meeting room where people are pitching ideas and discussions, but I'm kind of interested in when the hard decisions get made.
Yeah.
You know, you sound like you open it up for concepts. At some point, it's got to narrow down.
Right.
And I'm just interested in hearing, you know, how those calls get made and how that discussion happens, and maybe what criteria you use to make a tough decision.
Yeah. So it's like really fast paced, and I've become very decisive. And, you know, we do narrow things down pretty quickly. I don't, you know, I certainly, when we hire like an illustrator to come up with a concept, we usually tend to look through everything they send and decide what we like best, and then try and pitch that to our editor, who has the final say on things. We also work very closely with our photo department. Oftentimes we are working together to come up with a layout, or, you know, they often have a lot of ideas about which photographs should be used. They tend to, because they're in there almost like reporters getting all this information, they tend to have more information about the visuals. So oftentimes we'll work very closely with the photo department to decide what art works for a story. And then, you know, we'll together present, you know, that stuff to our editor, who again has the final say. But I'm sorry, I feel like I'm just rambling now. The question was, yeah. 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 So I really try and hear everybody out on my team. I hired them because they're really good at what they do. Even, you know, I don't think the experience level matters so much in some certain aspects. Everyone has really good ideas. That said, if I think the thing that they've done that they're in love with doesn't work, I just tell them. And so, but, you know, I try to be, our editor-in-chief is very open. I think it's a kind of a sign of being very sure of yourself. He's very open to being convinced of ideas. So he might feel strongly about something and he will, but he'll still hear me out. And fairly often, you know, he might agree to something that I think is the right thing to do that he didn't initially think is the right thing to do. And I also try to be open, you know, because sometimes I think a lot of things are just a matter of taste, you know, and particularly in the design department, I try to, you know, what I want from the team that I work with is to get the best out of them. And I think that you get that when you, you know, respect other people. And so there are points when it has to be guided in a certain way. And I usually, you know, try and give a reason, you know. And also there are points when I like that one, it looks better. And, you know, that's okay too.
I'm over here. It's clear from the work that you've shown and just the breadth of covers and the special issues and your team and yourself really take a lot of pride and energy, enthusiasm, heart and soul to put into this week after week.
Yeah.
The question that I have is, do you have a budget for each issue? Or, and if you do, what happens when you've got this great, fantastic conceptual idea that's going to take you to the four corners of the world?
Yeah.
But you have to fight for it? Or is it really the Times just says, we know you guys are good. We know that you're part of the reason that people come and read our publication, and we are willing to just, whatever your fancy is, just take it extreme. Darn.
I know. Well, some of them look like that. And it's funny, every time I show this JR cover, I always get questions about the budget. I actually, to be honest, we don't have a budget from week to week. And I don't actually know what the yearly budget is. I do sometimes get a call if I've exceeded it. but we're pretty conscientious about it. So you'll see things where we've clearly spent a lot of money. And then you'll also see like a type cover, which costs nothing. Yeah, it's about picking and choosing and trying to decide where you can have the most impact. We really are trying to make something surprising and, kind of delightful, which is we have a really different mission than the newspaper. And I think that luckily, our chief creative officer and the people there that are in power also understand that design really plays a big role. Design and photography, the visuals in general, play a big role in making the magazine what it is. And so we are lucky to have, a good amount of leeway and trust.
Hi. I think Minneapolis, as much as it is a design community, it's also an ad one.
Yeah.
And so I'm really curious about how you define the difference between a designer and an art director and like what that hierarchy looks like in your system.
Yeah. That's fun. I feel like it's different everywhere, right? Yeah. So, I mean, in my mind, an art director has to direct people, which I sometimes think is not actually... Some people that have that title, I'm not sure that they do. I think, art direction, I think to me is really about having a kind of larger vision for the brand. And also, some of the conceptual stuff, having a lot of big ideas about, that would span an entire issue. Interestingly, I feel like Matt, the art director of the magazine, and I have pretty different skill sets. He's often somebody that comes up with really a great idea, like the sideways turn of the magazine. He has actually started several magazines on his own and is used to talking with editors and kind of conceptualizing magazines as a whole. I think my strength is more looking at the art. I realize that I kind of love doing a lot of the concepting and thinking about ways to visualize things that are pretty hard to visualize. So and then we both actually direct people. And so in my group, I've tried to really tailor people's jobs to their particular skill sets. Matt doesn't particularly love managing a lot, and he does a lot more design. Our deputy art director, who's a bit younger, Ben Granginet, he has less experience but is incredibly talented. He actually does maybe a little more management and is kind of working on developing a lot of the directing skills, but I don't know. It's a lot of information. I'm not sure if it's what you wanted, but.
Quick one, as you're getting tired, this was wonderful. Thank you. Please tell me you archive or keep the props, like the square bicycle wheel. What happens to those things if they don't get washed away at night?
Yeah, the square bicycle wheel is sitting on top of my bookcase. we do. We try, and Jake is always saying that we should have a little museum of all the props that we make. I have the Trump balloon. I've got a lot of them. I have a little figurine that we made. We did a story on Hillary Clinton and how she's a hawk, and so we made a small soldier of her. I've got that. I could go on. We've got lots of stuff. Yeah.
Hi.
ask the last question of the series. It's cool, whatever. I heard you speak about this earlier, and I thought it was really fascinating. You mentioned the difference between the magazine and the newspaper, and how they have slightly different objectives. The newspaper is maybe more unbiased, and that's part of the New York Times brand, whereas your magazine is really about putting out opinions into the world. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about how you negotiate that relationship between those two very different publications and how it comes out through your art direction.
Yeah. Well, so I wouldn't say that the magazine is about putting opinions out there. It can be. You know, we definitely do a fair number of stories that have an opinion, but we're also held to a certain standard of being impartial, basically. And I know a lot of the things that I show don't look impartial, like the Trump balloon does not look impartial. But it was actually making a point that was in the piece. And so what we really try to do is be true to our content. But we also are, you know, making something pretty different. Like, you know, sometimes we have someone who deals with standards at the Times, and often they're asking a question about, you know, are you sensationalizing the story with the thing that you're making? And so, you know, I feel like a fair amount of good magazine covers do that, because that's what makes you want to pick up the magazine. So we are often trying to walk a line between making something that is true to the content, but also is kind of grabby. I feel like the paper is really about putting out news, although they also have like opinion sections, you know, and sometimes people get a little bit confused when they see an opinion piece and, you know, make comments about, you know, New York Times, so liberal or whatever, or, you know, it goes the other way too. But we're trying to kind of, differentiate our content so people understand it, you know, understand that there's our news that's supposed to be, is trying to be as straightforward as possible, really giving people facts and the truth, as the ad says. And then, you know, there are other things that we're doing as well that have equal value that can be about voice and opinion you know, that can be, for the magazine particularly, just entertaining and interesting. So hopefully we're doing that.
I think you are. Thank you very much.
Thanks.